This is State of the Unions. I'm Tim Schlittner.
And I'm Julie Green.
Later in the episode, we're going to talk to our friend and colleague, the trade policy specialist here at the AFL-CIO, Celeste Drake, yes. Who is one of the best, if not the best on
the
trade,
best.
The best the on best, trade in the entire it. Country, and is advocating for us all around the world and advocating for workers all around the world. We're going to talk to her about NAFTA, the trade deal that was adopted in 1994, so it's 25 years old, but is back on the table. Mm-hmm. And one of the campaign promises of President Trump was that he was going to improve that agreement. He called it the worst trade deal ever written. He ended up winning states like Ohio, Michigan, and Pennsylvania, largely on promises of a new trade order. Mm-hmm. And now it's time for the devil in the details, and the agreement before us, as Celeste explains in the interview, just isn't quite there yet.
It's not. And the thing that I really appreciate about the interview that Celeste gave is that she really was able to break down some complicated concepts around trade. As I fully admit, I don't understand all the nuances and the details about NAFTA. I don't understand why I should care.
We only have one person who understands all the nuances.
That's Celeste. She does it. She can do a good Venn diagram. She can even explain it so you can picture it in your head. One of the things that she said and she touched upon in the interview was this concept of the current president during the election cycle in 2016, kind of talking about trade and seemingly being on our side of that issue. And while it may seem that way, there really are some differences and some nuances there. And it's important to pull those out and to highlight them, because why we think the current bill is bad is not why he thinks the current bill is bad. And I think that that's something that folks really need to understand.
You're from Ohio. You talked about Lordstown in the GM episode we did, the jobs going to Mexico. How hungry do you think people are in places like Ohio for a new direction on trade?
Starving. It's everything. It's your job. It's what you do. And people spent 30, 40 years working in these plants, working at Lordstown. That's how they were able to support their families and their kids to school, have a good and secure retirement, healthcare. Everything kind of came down to those jobs, which aren't there anymore. That plant has closed. And we have yet to see the domino effect is going to be on that community and the jobs that weren't necessarily directly connected to trade. What's going to happen to the diner that a lot of those workers went to before work, at lunch, after work, that type of thing. So, I mean, this is something, and this is what Celeste got into, that really impacts workers who are in unions and those who are not, who work in these industries, but kind of the outlying parts of that exist in those communities. So I think just in general, folks just want this country to work, whether it's trade or anything else. They just want our elected officials to be able to come together to the table and just do some common sense things that are going to benefit and lift up us all, not focusing on one sector or another, but really just work together. Just want things to work.
I agree with that totally. And I think people want things to be fair.
Yes.
Just fair. Yes. They're not asking for a handout. They just want things to be fair. If they work hard, if they play by the rules, they want to be able to make money and have some benefits and have some retirement. And this trade deal is just not fair. No. And Celeste talks about it in the interview. It wasn't just about tariffs between the three countries. All of this other stuff was added to benefit big corporations, to put more money in the pockets of those who don't need it. Did nothing to change the culture in Mexico. $1 an hour wages in the 1990s, now it's up to like $2 an hour.
Right.
Jobs have gone down there in droves. And you talk about those communities. I was in a community called Galesburg, Illinois, and the Maytag plant went from Galesburg down to Mexico. And I talked to some of the people there, and they never had jobs that were the same as in the Maytag plant. The replacement jobs were nothing like it.
Yeah.
And then you have this trade adjustment assistance, which is basically the government program they give to people who lose their jobs because of trade. And
nowhere close.
One guy was telling me that someone had gone up to him who was part of the training for the trade adjustment assistance, and he worked at the Maytag plant. He was a skilled craftsman. And he was asked, have you ever considered going into cosmetology? These are the type of things that's just, there was just no sense of what that plant meant to that town.
Yeah.
And fair is fair. And this agreement is not fair. Now, President Trump has not been fair for the workers he employed, for the contractors he employed, and for working people as president. Let's be perfectly clear. He is not a person that exercises fairness in any way, shape, or form. But he did see this deal as broken and as something that needed to be fixed. So that's why the labor movement's at the table trying to hold them to that one promise.
That's right.
If we can get that one promise, at least we get that out of this administration. With that, let's turn it over to our interview with the AFL-CIO trade policy specialist, Celeste Drake. Welcome to our latest episode where we're going to talk about NAFTA and where we're at with this debate of a 25-year-old trade deal. And we're very excited to be joined by our colleague, our friend, the AFL-CIO's trade expert, Celeste Drake. Yay. Celeste, thank you for being here.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So a couple of facts about NAFTA as we start, and then we'll get into where we are now. NAFTA took force January the 1st of 1994. Let's all say how old we were in 1994.
Okay, no.
Can we not?
I was 12. All right, I've been rejected for that.
I was older than 12.
Okay, we were all somewhere between 12 and 20.
Sure.
Okay. 850,000 jobs have been shipped overseas under NAFTA. Some estimates, I think, go up north of a million. The trade deficit between the U.S. and Mexico and Canada has increased tenfold in the 25 years under NAFTA. So this became a campaign issue in 2016 with President Trump talking about NAFTA a lot on the campaign trail. But NAFTA is not new for us. Labor movement has been talking about NAFTA since its outset. Then renegotiations began in May of 2017. There were 9 rounds of talks that went on, with eventually an agreement being reached between the United States, Mexico, and Canada in September of 2018. Fast forward to today, we now have this debate sort of front and center. So Celeste, NAFTA's 25 years old.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about this agreement and why we're talking about it 25 years later.
Sure. Well, there is a lot of repetition here. In fact, when I've gone back and done research into what was the congressional debate on NAFTA the first time around back in 1993, I will see the exact same arguments being used now as were used then. So it's unfortunate that we haven't, as a country, learned as much as we should have from the first NAFTA. But I will say it is the first comprehensive trade agreement that really did more than just lower tariffs and lower quotas. So it's talked about, right? NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, it's in the name. So it implies it's all about moving goods from place to place. But it included rules on how you can regulate banks, how you can trade in services, right? And how do you move services across borders? You don't. It's about moving people or providing a service online or over the phone or back in the day, you know, through the mail. It included rules after much debate to try and protect labor, which is working people, and to try and protect the environment. But since those things were added on, they were weak and ineffective and they never worked. And what we've got is the sum total of a bunch of rules that favor global corporations and reward their greed and their mistreatment of people and the environment. And sort of these guidelines are very ineffective rules that are supposed to be helping working people and making sure that we have clean water to drink and clean air to breathe.
So I guess something I've always wondered, and I'm not a person that understands NAFTA, the history of NAFTA, or any of that well, is why can't we just scrap it? Why are we trying to improve this already flawed agreement? Why can't we replace it with something better?
That's a great question. So scrapping it is possible, but it's really unpopular, not only with the companies, but in some cases with the workers, because now we've been operating under NAFTA's rules for 25 years. And a lot of companies just straight up close their factories in the U.S., move those factories to Mexico, and basically operate from Mexico. But a lot of them have these really long and complicated supply chains where the goods might go from Mexico to the U.S., back to Mexico, over to Canada, and these long involved processes. And that creates fear amongst companies that if there's no NAFTA at all, these supply chains will be hurt, fear amongst workers that if things really don't work out with no NAFTA at all, that maybe the jobs just go to China or Vietnam or Thailand or elsewhere. So I think it's a lot of these questions that you hear from businesses about certainty and and uncertainty. So the best thing for working people, since we know the current NAFTA is so awful, is to do what you suggested, replace it with something wholly new, with a whole different set of rules that say workers are at least as important as businesses, and we're going to have rules to make sure if working people are abused, if the environment is exploited, that is what we're protecting, rather than these very strong rules to protect businesses, which we have right now, and these guidelines for people.
So our position is there should be a North American free trade agreement. Before NAFTA, the idea of what a trade agreement was an agreement between all three countries to reduce tariffs on goods moving between the three countries.
Yep.
But what the agreement ended up being was something much more, almost a financial agreement for companies, businesses, Wall Street. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's exactly right. People thought it was going to be just about goods. It turned out to be something very different. And what we knew, what existed in Mexico for 50 years at least before NAFTA, were these institutions called protection unions and these things called protection contracts. And what they really are, not unions the way that we would think of them. They are not democratic, responsive organizations that workers organize, that workers can vote for the leaders, and that workers can say, hey, I don't like the current president of my local. Next time we have an election, we'll choose somebody else. It doesn't work that way. So in Mexico, these protection unions, they're really organizations that we would think of in the U.S. as somewhat criminal organizations. Mm-hmm. They collaborate and cooperate with employers. They basically get kickbacks from employers, and the sole reason that they exist is to keep real unions out of the workplaces. So that was going on before NAFTA, and it was one of the reasons the AFL-CIO and our affiliate unions said, we can't have this. If what we're going to do is reduce trade barriers and also make it easier to outsource and have all these other rights for big banks and, like you said, a financialization agreement, if we don't do something to bring up those labor standards in Mexico, what's going to happen is all of North America is going to tilt toward the lowest standards, and those are in Mexico, and that's really what has happened. And that was, I think, some members of Congress who voted for NAFTA the first time around were, you know, they were sort of swayed by this idea that somehow it will level standards up. And they really believed that free trade was going to be positive and effective. And it turns out that the skeptics the first time around and the unions and our allies in the environmental movement and the faith community, we were right, because you can't set up all these rules to protect money and capital and businesses and not have rules that protect working people, because what you're going to get is downward pressure on wages, downward pressure on safety in the workplace, downward pressure on the ability just to organize a union and to bargain effectively.
Wow. Okay. Thank you. Because I know earlier before we started recording, I was like, why do we care about what Mexico is doing? Like, why would the average worker like care that that's a factor in our overall stance on where things are right now? Now, you're one of the few people in this federation, probably in this city, probably in this country, who literally is like a foremost expert on trade. And you've had the ability to be inside of these negotiations with both sides, probably across multiple administrations. What is that like? Because this just seems like such a big thing. And there's so many different aspects of it, goods, people, working conditions, all of that. Tell us a little bit about what that experience has been like for you.
So you've got to be flexible and you've got to want to learn things, because as we were talking about, these trade agreements cover so much. So I need to know a little bit about health policy, a little bit about regulatory policy, a little bit about a lot of different industries that are heavily traded. And you go into these rooms and often you're the only person representing labor, or sometimes even the only person representing a non-business interest. And their initial reaction is, what could you possibly have to say that's useful? And sort of the assumption that, well, you're from labor, you don't have good ideas, or you don't have modern ideas, kind of this sort of stuck in the past that sometimes people mischaracterize unions as. But then you start talking and they realize, I've done my homework, I am experienced, I do have expertise. And it's not, let's not trade, it's let's trade, but let's set up particular rules so that we're not skewing all the benefits just to businesses, but that businesses and workers can prosper together. other. And so you make progress really millimeters at a time. But the most frustrating part is then leaving those rooms. And because of the way the United States does trade negotiations, I can't tell most of what I know because it's confidential. So I can talk to President Trumka about it. I can talk to some of the other, the affiliate presidents, but the average union member on whose behalf I'm working, I'm not allowed to tell them a lot of the things that I know. So it's a frustrating experience, and it's really in contradiction to how unions operate, where we try and share information and we try and be as transparent as possible. And you have to keep going at it. Here we are. I think Tim started out by saying, we negotiated NAFTA 25 years ago. Here we are again. It's a lot of the same things over and over. And you just have to measure progress sometimes by, well, we like the TPP, we weren't able to get a good progressive trade agreement that would work for workers, but we were able to stop it. So sometimes your goals are pretty minor, but in the scheme of things, I think we're doing better and better at getting issues important to working people more on the agenda.
Mm-hmm. When you took the job here, did you ever think you'd get a crack at NAFTA?
No.
So what's that been like?
You know, it's been a great opportunity. And I wish that it really had been a scrapping of the whole, just tearing up the whole thing and starting fresh, because that would give us the best chance for really positive rules where we really could say, we all get it. It's true, an injury to one is an injury to all. And I've got to care about the workers in Mexico and getting their wages up, because that's the only way I'm going to get my wages up. But really, it's been sort of knocking things around the edges. And there's been a few really meaningful improvements. So one is, there's a whole chapter in NAFTA that sets out really specific and comprehensive rights for investors. So that means when a business, for instance, we'll say Mondelez, which closed a plant making Oreos here in the US and fairly recently, a few years ago, opened a plant in Salinas. When they invest in Mexico, they have a bunch of rights as investors in Mexico that Mexican-owned companies don't have and that they wouldn't have except for NAFTA. And it's actually an incentive to outsource, because Mondelez can say to itself, hey, if we put our new plant there in Mexico, look at this whole list of rights that we're going to have. So those are rolled back. And that's a big deal in the new NAFTA, because it eliminates some of the incentives to outsource. But then there's some things that we just weren't able to take a crack at, like rail workers. A U.S. citizen cannot work in Mexico on the railway, but Mexican citizens can work on U.S. railways. And that might be, if you think about it, something that in future years threatens U.S. railway workers' jobs, because if rail companies are able to bring Mexican workers here and pay them Mexican wages and say they're not really working in the U.S., they're just going over the border, that can drive everybody's wages down. So there's a lot of things that we just didn't really touch in terms of fixing. And I hope we don't have to wait 25 years to get another crack at fixing those things, because there's a lot more work to be done.
I think the way we often are looking at trade is through the lens of like the unions and the workers who are affected by it, right? So people who work in the auto industry, the steel industry. But how does NAFTA and the importance of these negotiations, like however this lands, why is it important to your teacher, to the guy who delivers your mail, to people who don't work necessarily in those industries, but who have neighbors and are in communities that are impacted? Why should they care?
They should care because what happens to the workers who are impacted by trade, and whether those workers are in a union or not in a union, that impacts their job and their wages. So I'll give an example. Let's say that you're in a small town, you're not a big metropolis, but a smaller town in the Midwest or in the South. And there are a lot of places, for instance, furniture and textile and apparel in the South, and a lot of heavy manufacturing, appliances, auto in the Midwest. These places have closed and continue to close and have work transferred to Mexico. And let's just take an average worker. If the big factory is gone, so that person then is on the job market in that local town, along with maybe dozens or hundreds or even thousands of his or her coworkers. That's going to drive down the wages that all the comparable workers in that community can get. And there's actually data showing that a waiter or waitress in a cafe could command lower wages after the factories in his or her town were closed because there are more people on the job market. And then you mentioned teachers and postal workers. So think about public services, right? Local communities have to provide libraries, parks, law enforcement, schools. When factories close, they're not getting the property tax revenue they were before. They're maybe not getting the sales tax because the people that were going out to lunch on their work break are no longer going out to lunch. For the federal government, you probably have a reduction in revenue in personal income tax. All of that eventually adds up. And there certainly are communities that, as a result of losing major employers, had to face tough decisions about, do we make layoffs? Do we institute pay freezes? So really, in a sense, we are all in this together. And it doesn't matter whether we started out with the union or we started out without a union. In the end, we're all subject to the same forces. And those forces, rather than lifting us up as they should do, they're pushing us down. But the money's being made and it's going somewhere. And we have to remember the economy's not the weather. And those profits from trade are really being captured, but they're being captured by these global companies. And we've lost some of our bargaining power, those of us lucky enough to have a union, to then go to the company and say, when we negotiate this contract, we're going to get some of those profits back because we're the ones who made the value. And that's getting harder and harder to do. And that's why we're here trying to share this information with folks, right? So we can make it.
Exactly.
How close is the labor movement's trade view to President Trump's trade view?
That's a good question.
It's a really good question. I would describe it as a Venn diagram, if people can think of overlapping circles, right? So there's actually a fairly narrow place where we agree with him. And that is that we should make sure that U.S. trade policies reduce the trade deficit. And the trade deficit is where we import more than we export. And all that means is those are what economists call opportunity costs. If we're importing more than we're exporting, those are jobs Americans could have had, but didn't have, right? And it's out of balance. So we agree that we should work to reduce the trade deficit. It's not the only important thing in trade, but it's important. It's about jobs. We agree that if we have a trade agreement, we ought to actually enforce the rules. He talks about enforcement. And that means if we know that a rule is being violated, we shouldn't just overlook it. Let's go after it and let's enforce it. Why? Because in the end, that's about jobs and wages. So let's enforce. And he agrees with us on that. Well, when he was campaigning, he said, I think the TPP is a bad deal. And he said the NAFTA is the worst trade agreement ever. And I think most union members would agree with those statements. Now, why he thinks the deals are bad and why we think the deals are bad, I think that's where we start to diverge. Okay. And you will hear him say things like, Mexico got the best of us in NAFTA, or look at those Mexicans, they're doing so great, they have all our jobs. And we would say, that's 100% wrong. As I described these protection unions in Mexico, they act to keep wages down. Mexican workers are not benefiting from NAFTA. It's these big companies. And it wasn't that Mexican negotiators were so much smarter than American negotiators. It's that together, Canadian negotiators, American negotiators, Mexican negotiators put in a set of rules that really benefited the corporations.
All three countries sold out their workers.
Yeah, they did. That's just absolutely the case. And so what we need to do as workers is say we have more in common across borders than we have differences. And that's where we really would say the president's focus, when he starts sounding xenophobic or racist or anti-immigrant, that is not the labor union view. The labor union view is all workers together.
So as we're talking, it's early spring of 2019. What do you think the timeline for this looks like in terms of a new NAFTA getting hammered out? What does the administration want the timeline to be? Where do we realistically think it is? And then what can we do to help influence getting the best deal possible out of this?
So the administration would like to have the votes completely over by this summer. They haven't been more specific than that, but that's coming up.
Oh, yeah.
We've got fast track in place, which in theory says once Congress gets the bill, they've got to push it down this legislative luge run where it speeds really quickly.
Up or down, no amendments. That's fast track, right?
Yeah. And limited debate. Can't bottle it up in committee. The Senate can't use the filibuster. So it just goes. However, Speaker Pelosi has shown that she's willing to do this. Congress can always say, wait a minute, we don't want to use the fast track rules. We're going to use our own rules. And when the second President Bush, George W. Bush, sent up the Colombia Free Trade Agreement, and Speaker Pelosi at the time said, no, I'm not going to move it. Colombia has too many serious labor problems. He said, well, I'm sending it up. I have fast track. You're going to have to move it. And she said, no, we don't, and stopped it. Now we're operating under a system where we've got another Republican president. We've got Speaker Pelosi in charge of the House, and they've really got to work together to get it to be something where Speaker Pelosi says, yes, I'll move it. And that's where we come in. You ask what we can do. What we say is, look, there are some improved things in this new NAFTA. I talked about the incentives for investors to outsource being rolled back. There are some stronger labor rules that are really important if we can get them enforced, but there really aren't any enforcement tools. And there's some stronger rules on autos that could encourage more jobs in the U.S. We don't really know if those are going to work out. We need some more data, but there's a few things that it's a good start if we can get more. So we need to get rid of some incentives in there, some giveaways to big pharma that could keep drug prices high, which are huge issue for working families.
Again, why that is even a part of NAFTA.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's inexplicable unless you're pharma and you want to get rules that just add to your profits. There's no other reason for it being there. But we can make those changes. And how do we make those changes? We've got to tell Congress, no vote until it's fixed, and get them to lay down the law and say, we're not just going to do you a favor, President Trump, and move your deal because you say it's better. Mm. We're going to wait and make sure that it is better. And we've got to get these changes in.
What do you see as the ideal outcome?
Yeah. So we had 18 recommendations for the renegotiation.
Wow.
And the answer to whether or not we achieved our goal on the vast majority of those is no. Like half of them were straight up no. The rest of them were some kind of ish, maybe. But more important than that, right, than the scorecard is, what's the biggest, most meaningful change that's not in there that needs to be made? And that's around labor. It's protections for workers so that workers in all three countries have a right to organize a union, to collectively bargain a contract, to not be discriminated against in the workplace, and to be free from forced and child labor, right? And the things that go along with that. And that's sort of better, but with no enforcement. And the rest of it, kind of, if we can fix that, make sure that the labor protections are right, that they can really be enforced, not just enforceable, meaning, yeah, it's enforceable maybe someday if we feel like it, maybe. But there are rules that say these rules will be enforced. So if there's a factory, if there's an office, if there's a workspace, and workers are being exploited, and the government is not doing its job to enforce those provisions, that we can say to our trading partners, fix this. And if you don't fix it, there will be a trade sanction. That will be meaningful. Get that in and take out those giveaways to big pharma, which is probably the worst of the bad stuff. And then I think you really do have something that's worth putting in place, because if you were able to do those things, you know, more for workers, less for big pharma, you'd have something that on balance, you could say, isn't a perfect agreement, isn't the agreement we would write, but is better for workers. And it's worth kind of grabbing and locking that in. And then, of course, we can get on with our bigger or more comprehensive trade reform later.
Then you could go to Pennsylvania and Ohio and North Carolina and Texas and with a straight face say, we improved this agreement.
Yeah.
It wasn't the best we could get, but it's something that's worth supporting.
It's something that's worth supporting. And that's doable. That's doable with the help of the House to say, we're not just going to take any old trade agreement and vote on it. It's doable if the administration can be convinced, yes, let's go back to the table and just fix these few things. We don't need to start completely over, but fix these things. And it's doable if union members and other interested folks speak up and tell their members of Congress and tell the president, this is what we want to happen.
What do you say to those on the left that don't want to give Trump a win?
I say workers' lives are more important than sort of short-term political strategizing. That's my first answer. And I think my second answer is, look, President Trump has a big enough record that's mostly anti-worker, that if folks want votes and they want to take votes from Trump and say, we've got a better agenda for workers, that's doable, right? So sort of this fear that if we do something that's better for workers, somebody we don't like might potentially get some credit. I think that's ridiculous. Instead, let's have the folks that you want to get credit for doing things for workers, have them do things for workers and then publicize it. If the Democrats in the House get the deal fixed, they should be running around saying, this is fixed. The Democrats fixed the deal that wasn't good enough, and they should take credit for that. And so rather than be afraid they might not win that publicity battle, do what's right for workers and then figure out a way to win the publicity battle.
I'm giving the credit to Celeste.
I like
Celeste
it. I know, me too. Anyway, so. Me too.
Can we talk about you leaving?
Yeah, we can.
Is it okay?
I think that's okay, yeah.
Okay, so Celeste is moving on to her next gig.
Sad face.
Sad
Big
face.
Big sad face.
I mean, really tough blow for the AFL-CIO, for the labor movement, for all of our unions. Celeste, you and I work together on the Hill. I've just always been so impressed by you, your professionalism, your positive attitude on an issue that's so tough. I just respect the hell out of you, and we'll miss you a lot.
Me too. You're a very powerful voice for women here in the building, and many others who you've worked with and have represented. And I know you're going to be missed.
Thank you so much.
We're excited for you, though.
Thanks.
You're going, but you're not going far. You're not leaving the movement.
I will say, working for the AFL-CIO, it's just been an amazing opportunity. I think when I left the Hill, I wasn't sure if I wanted to leave the Hill. I worked for a couple of different members of Congress before I came over here.
And I was sure I did, by the way.
Yeah. Once I left, I was like, yeah. I mean, I never want to see another piece of constituent mail.
Oh. Right? Postcards.
But I feel like I really have affected the debate. And the most rewarding part is when I'm asked to speak somewhere. So I'm lucky enough to get these invitations, and maybe I go speak on behalf of working people in Nairobi, Kenya, or maybe I go speak on behalf of working people in Orange Beach, Alabama. But it's meeting real trade unionists and union members and, you know, knowing that we're really all in this together. That's been fantastic. So I've learned a lot. I've actually had an opportunity to represent unionized workers at the AFL-CIO on our staff union. And it's been really great. So I'm glad that I got the opportunity, and, you know, it's bittersweet, but I will be moving on and living in the great state of California.
Well, just take care of that NAFTA thing and we'll be all set.
Yes.
We've been talking with the incomparable trade policy specialist at the AFL-CIO, Celeste Drake. This is State of the Unions.
This has been State of the Unions. Thanks for listening. Join us every other week for a conversation about the labor movement, organizing, and all things that affect us at work.
Make sure you never miss an episode by subscribing and rating us on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts. And until next time, keep up to date on all things labor by following us on Twitter @AFLCIO.